It's good to be back because last week I was away. I was at Tiong Man Island. I accompanied my son for his open water dive. My son wanted to be certified as a diver for some of his schoolwork, so I accompanied him. I did my diving course more than 20 years ago, so this was like my refresher for myself. So because I'm part of the refresher group, I dive with the rest of the leisure divers for the first four dives. Right? So my son had to go with the instructor, but I dive with the rest of the leisure diver. Yeah, that's me without my glasses. Then what happened is that after every dive, when I come out of the water, I will always stare towards the boat and make sure that my son came out as well. The kanchong father in me lah. Huh? Yeah, because I love my son a lot. Somebody said that, Pastor Seng Lee, your illustration always about your daughter. You hardly talk about your son. Eh? Today I talk about my son, okay? So I was so glad to see him always surface every dive. Now, on the last dive, my dive buddy is the Angmoh guy at the back, all right? My dive buddy decided not to dive for the fifth dive for a very simple reason, because he's taking a flight within 24 hours. So part of the safety regulation, he's not supposed to dive. So guess who is my dive buddy on the fifth dive? Of course, my son. All right, so the last dive lasted about 55 minutes. It brought so much joy in my heart to see my son, how he tried to master the ability to swim underwater, how he maneuvered his buoyancy, and how he made his safety stop. But the greatest joy for me was to have my son with me under the water. Right? Then suddenly it hit me that I actually caught a glimpse of our Father's heart for us. You see, that's how our Father God feels for us when we are with Him. When we are flowing in doing His will, when we are one with Him, that's how much He feels. And I caught a glimpse of that. And then suddenly the Lord reminded me that's where John 17 is all about. And so I'd like us to pray right now and ask God to unpack John 17 for all of us here today. Let's pray. Lord, we just want to thank You again for Your word, for Your living word. I pray this day that, Lord, that indeed You will come and remove every distraction in our hearts, in our minds, and help us to meditate on Your word, and let Your Holy Spirit come and breathe fresh revelation to all of us, so that our life may be changed by Your living word. Lord, indeed hide Thy servant behind the cross, so that, Lord, everything that come forth from this pulpit be the very word of God for Your people today. I should pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So just to quickly recap, the first time I unpacked John 7 2 weeks ago, I shared with you that Jesus' prayer was, Father, the hour has come, glorify Your Son. Jesus was very consumed with the glory of God. And therefore, for us, the implication for us is that how can you and I glorify God? And we need to die to ourselves and direct others to God. And so Celebration of Hope presents for us a wonderful opportunity for us to direct others to God. So we are thankful to Pastor Edric that shared with us why BPTC need to get involved in Celebration of Hope. He shared with us about what's your part in the Celebration of Hope. So I trust that you remember his sermon and you start acting on the instruction given. All right. But today, right now, let's come back to John 17 again. Now, before I start my sermon today, okay, let me just give you a preamble. People say today is Bible study day. All right, so yes, I'm going to take you through a Bible study on John 17. Now, before we get there, I just want to share with you this. Do you think God answered Jesus' prayer? His first prayer from verse 1 to verse 5. Do you think God answered Jesus' prayer? Yes, no? Yes, all right. His prayer will be answered because He's God. All right, He's praying the heart of God. Now, how do we know? I just want to quote you a passage just to sum that out, and then I'll move on, okay? It's taken from Philippians 2. Philippians 2 verse 5 tells us this: have this attitude in yourself, which was also in Christ Jesus, who though He existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied Himself, taking the form of a bond servant, being made in the likeness of man, being found in appearance of a man, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. So herein is a good summary for us again about Jesus glorify God by dying. Then He goes on to tell us, for this reason also, what's this reason? That He died for the glory of God. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee will bow, and of those who are in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, that every tongue will confess Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So did God answer Jesus' prayer? Yes. All right, so you can see that Jesus was glorified because God highly exalted him, that above every name, that every knee will bow to this name, all right, to the glory of God. So you can see that God the Father answered Jesus' prayer. Now, I want to highlight that because I want to give you the assurance that God will answer the rest of the prayer. Amen? So therefore, it is important for you and I to pay attention to John 17 because this prayer will be answered. All right, it'll be good for you and I to pay attention because so that you can align your life to the scripture because it will be answered. Coming back to this confusing map again. Right, this is the summary of verse 1 to 26. All right, I basically highlighted all the keywords, not so much to impress you, but more so to help you to see some of the repeated words. All right, so from verse 6 to verse 26, beside the red color that's very loud, can you see another color that's repeated a lot? Can you see the purple color? Right, purple color is repeated almost every line. Now, purple color, I highlighted basically the word they, those, them. Right, these are the three words Jesus used in his prayer describing the disciples, describing you and I. You get the picture? So 80% of this chapter is devoted to praying for you and I. That's how special you are to God. You see, Jesus only committed 5 verses to pray for himself, but the rest of 20 over verses is dedicated to pray for you and I. That's how special we are to him. All right, God, you are very much in the prayer of God. So the question is that, what exactly is Jesus praying for us about? All right, so let me give you the outline first. So today what I'm going to do is that I've introduced the thing about oneness with the Father. Just as my son and I being one in the under the water brought joy to me, God wants you and I to be one with him because that will bring much joy to him and to us. But before that, I want to give you first the overview of the prayer so that you can see the 4 petitions of Jesus. Then we'll try to find out what's the implication of it and how you and I can do something about it. All right? So are you ready? And you tell the person beside you, Bible study time. All right? Some people say, Pastor Stanley, I've never seen you preach like that before. So yes, okay, this is Bible study time. Huh? No, so let's dive deep and I'll show you one part of the prayer first as an example, the first petition. So Jesus prayed, I ask on their behalf, I do not ask on the behalf of the world, but of those whom you have given me, for they are yours. And all things that are mine are yours and yours are mine. So talk about a lot of the oneness within God himself. All right, and I've been glorifying them. I'm no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world. I come to you, Holy Father. Now, verse 9 to verse 11 give us the reason why this prayer. It set for us the context. It set for us the reason. Then comes the actual prayer. What is the actual prayer? It's in the box. What's the actual prayer? Keep them in your name. So the first prayer that Jesus prayed for you and I is protection. Protect us. Protect the disciples. Keep them in your name, the name that you've given to me. This is the petition. Protect them. But in Jesus' prayer, not only they give you the reason, he give you the prayer, he also give you the outcome. The outcome of the prayer. The outcome of the prayer is that they may be one, even as we are. Now, I'm helping you to see that because you can see these three parts. The reason for the prayer itself, and the outcome. These three items are repeated throughout all the 4 different petitions. So because of time, I've summarized them into a chart for you. All right? So you can see what's the petition. Keep them in your name, protection. Why the petition? Because Jesus is no longer in the world. And then the outcome of the petition, that they may be one. These are repeated for the next 3 prayers, which is about sanctification. Jesus is sanctifying them. Why? Because Jesus is sending us into the world to make a difference. All right. So Jesus' prayer to the Father is sanctify them. The outcome is that we will be sanctified by the Word. The next prayer is that they may be one. All right. Why? Because The Father and Son are one, and He wants us to be one. The outcome, so that they may know that You sent Me, which is the vindication of Jesus. All right? Then the last prayer, which is the last part of the chapter, be with Me. Jesus prayed to the Father, I want them to be with Me. Why? So that you and I can see God's ultimate glory. And what's the outcome? That you may experience the love of God in our hearts. So these are the four prayers that Jesus made for us. But can you see that these four prayers are interrelated? You see, they are interrelated because if you don't have protection, what will happen? You have no oneness. When you don't have oneness, you won't have sanctification. When you don't have sanctification, you won't have vindication. And of course, you won't be able to experience the passion. So you can see that the way Jesus prays is that the prayer is comprehensive. They are all interrelated. You take any of these elements out, this whole prayer will collapse. And now time does not allow me to talk further about the way Jesus prayed, but I just want to give you to us that this is how the Lord prays. It's very comprehensive. It's all interrelated. Now, just sit back a bit and look at this and say that, what's one thing that repeated throughout the whole four prayers? There's something that connect all four together. And the word is, I already front-loaded just now. The word is? The word is? One. Oneness, okay? That's the ultimate desire of God, that we be one. Right? The desire of God for you and I is one. That we'll be one with Him and one with one another. So what's the implication for us today? See, throughout the prayer from verse 6 right up to 26, the concern of Jesus for us is about oneness. And if God is so concerned about oneness, what should our response? We should be too, right? If this is something that Jesus is bothered with, we should be bothered too. And then when we allow ourselves to do that, and we live, how can we live it out? As we choose to live out that oneness, so that you and I can experience the blessing of God. I shared with you just now that this prayer will be answered. So if you and I align our life to this prayer, you will experience the blessing of God, you will experience the purpose of God, you will experience the will of God. Right? So church, I want to encourage us, let's learn how to be one. So how can you and I be one? Two simple outline. How to achieve oneness? First, you and I must be one with God. Second, you and I must understand how to be one with others in the body of Christ. All right? So let me start. Okay? Verse 6 to verse 8. But I want you to have a feel of the prayer first. All right? Now, these few verses helps us to know how to be one with God. Like, how do I see that? Let me just quickly give you the outline that I unpack for you. All right? You will recognize that in order for you and I to be one with God, you must recognize that we are special. We are a gift from God to Jesus. That's a special position that God has given to us. Second, we must keep His word. How to keep His word? We must first receive. Just as now we are learning how to receive the word of God, not only that you must receive, you must understand. You see, if you don't understand, you can't do the third part, which is to believe. All right, you need to receive, you need to understand, then you believe. Okay, let me show you. The first part is, they were yours and you gave them to Me. So what Jesus is really saying to the Father God is that, Father God, these people, they are yours, but you have gifted them to Me as a gift. So what it means is that you and I, disciples of God, we are first and foremost belong to Father God. And Father God give us to Jesus. It's not because something that you work about it, something that you earn, but it's because of the fact that you are chosen. People of God, remember this. You are chosen. God has chosen you. God has selected you. And God has gave you to Jesus as a gift. That's a wonderful privilege to be in. You see, to the world, you and I may not mean anything. But to God, you are a gift from His Father to Him. You are special. Help me tell the person beside you are special. Because you don't look very convinced. You are special. You know, it's very special to be a gift to God. Right? Now, we need to have a healthy self-esteem or healthy self-estimate of our esteem in order for us to really have this oneness with God. Because if you and I keep thinking poorly of ourselves, or we keep thinking lowly of ourselves, you and I might not be able to experience the oneness with God. So how can we, so this leads me to what must we do to help us to appreciate that. And that's where the verse continues. They have kept your word. One of the things that helped them to know that they are special is because from the word of God, they have kept the word of God. Now they come to know that everything you have given to me is from you. For the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they receive them. What's the them here? Receive them refer to the words. Right? The words that God has given to Jesus has given to us. All right? Then we receive the word, and then we truly understood the word. Is that how it says? You see, and truly understood that I came forth from you. Meaning this, the word of God is given to us, not so much that we will know more about the word, but rather that the word is given to us so that we can understand who Jesus is. Church, don't understand the distinction. You study the Bible for the purpose of knowing God. You don't study the Bible just as an end in itself. The word of God helps the people to understand that Jesus came forth from the Father. You get that? Then once you understand, so when you receive the word, from the word you understand who Jesus is, then you are ready to move to the last part, which is to believe that he sent me. See, our belief is flawed if we don't have a proper understanding. All right, we need to have a proper understanding before we can truly believe. You see, when we truly believe who Jesus is, then you understand how special you are. You see, our view of God affects how we feel about ourselves. Let me illustrate that. Just an illustration, okay? Just imagine if you have a special private dinner with the celebrities of your life, the people that you look up to, okay? Maybe for some of you, you're not hot about Korean actors, maybe local actress. Okay, doesn't matter. Who are your celebrities? Who are the people that you look up to? Who are the people that you admire? So can you imagine if you have a private dinner with them, sponsored by them, right? They are paying for the dinner just to catch up with you, just to know you. How does that make you feel? Do you feel special? Wouldn't you feel special that the someone that you look up to want to have a dinner with you, paid for some more? All right, you feel special, you feel good, isn't it? Now, I want you to multiply that many times over because Jesus Christ is the ultimate celebrities. Well, nobody say amen. Jesus Christ is the ultimate celebrities. All right, because Jesus is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He's far greater than any celebrities in your life. He's far greater than any idols in our hearts. He is God, Lord Almighty. And you are his. You see, when we truly believe who Jesus is, if you truly believe who Jesus is, you know what will happen to you? If you truly believe who Jesus is, then you discover the people of this world will begin to dim in the light of who he is. If you truly believe who Jesus is, you will look up and your heart will reach out to God. Your hearts will be filled with adoration for him. Your hearts will be filled with love and affection for the one who loves you. And then you will want to make sure that you will not hurt him because he has become someone important to you. If you truly believe who he is. And when you do that, you become one with God. How can you and I become one with God? You need to recognize how special you are. How can you recognize how special you are? You need to know the word of God. Then the world will pale in comparison to the surpassing glory of who God is. But you and I cannot be one with God if you don't fully believe who Jesus is. You and I cannot fully believe in God if you don't believe in the word of God. In my work as a pastor, I do some counseling. I do meet up with some people. Just this week, a pastor from another church brought a family to see me. Usually when that happens, usually it's a very complicated case. So the story cut, long story cut short, basically the son has been listening to the voice of the friend. And in the school, the friend speaks negative things about him. And instead of putting his heart on what the word of God say, he put his heart on what the people say. And because of that, it affected him so much that he has to be medically warded into IMH yesterday. See, this is what happened to us when we don't take the word of God seriously. We allow the words of the world to affect us. I know of a sister who, believer, and even though she has been a Christian for a long time, but yet deep down in her heart, she never really believed that God has forgiven her. Even though the word of God says that when you confess your sin, God will forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. But yet deep down in her heart, because of something she has done in the past, she never really believed that God has forgiven her. And as a result, she cannot experience the oneness with God. So church, I want to encourage us today. God wants you to be one with Him. And how can you and I be one with Him? You need to know that you are special to God. It doesn't matter what the world say, but you are special to God. And how can you know that you're special to God? You need to get back to the Word of God. You need to receive the Word, understand the Word, and believe what God say about who He is to you. I'd like to show you a video clip. Today we officially launched this video clip for Celebration of Hope, Belinda's Lee testimony. But actually it's a testimony about her mother. But as you watch this testimony, I want to encourage you to look out for that oneness that the mother has with God. How she achieved that oneness with God. So sit back and watch this video clip.
I was there when it was first announced that she had cancer. I would never ever forget my mom's face. To her, it was almost like it was a death sentence. The first 3 years was extremely difficult because she was just depending on her own strength and understanding to live life. So she was desperate to be cured and she did whatever that she could. But she was fighting so hard and she had a lot of questions that were unanswered. Why did I get cancer? How did it happen? Does it mean I'm gonna die? What's gonna happen to my family? There were a lot of struggles and I think there was unforgiveness deep down in her heart. But the moment she decided that it was time to let go of that rock, she held on to God's hands and said, yeah, this is the rock. I'll give it to you. I'll give it to you. And that was when God took it out and said, this is my gift to you, sweetheart. My gift of peace, my gift of hope to you, and my gift of eternal life. Her entire countenance changed. There was such joy and radiance on her face. Nobody could tell that she was a cancer survivor. It was the glory of God shining upon her face that was absolutely beautiful. I still remember during the last remaining days of my mom, she was extremely weak, very frail, and she had no strength to even sit up in bed. But I remember there was one night at about 1 a.m., she suddenly sat up, stood up, and with all her might and her strength, she held on to anything that she could hold on to, the window grills, the bed, the wardrobe, anything. And she would walk slowly towards a mirror. And she would look at herself in the mirror. And all of a sudden, she would scream out at the top of her voice,
"耶和华, 求你带我回家!"
Where did she even get the strength from? Even in her darkest moment, she had hope in the Lord that He will welcome her with open arms and take her home. That was the hope that she had in Jesus Christ. At the very, very last part of her life, And for many of you who might be living with a lot of hopelessness within you right now, and you don't even tell people about it, but you live in despair and you live in hopelessness, you live with this huge rock in your heart, and you can't seem to find hope anywhere, I sincerely hope that you will be able to let go of that baggage. Find hope at the Celebration of Hope this coming May from the 17th to 19th at the National Stadium. And I believe that it will change your life forever.
This video clip is made available on the Celebration of Hope website. You can download it, send it to your non-Christian friend and so forth. But coming back for our sermon today, can you see the oneness that the mother has with God? That she believes, that she knows that she belongs to God. Right? So that therefore in her darkest moments, she doesn't look out to anybody else except to God, Jehovah God. Right? Then you know that even though, you know, in the earlier part when she was still in her flesh, when she was still struggling with a lot of question, unforgiveness, until she learned to obey the word of God, until she learned to surrender to God, her countenance changed. Right? So how can you and I have that oneness with God? We must know how special you are. You must know that you are with God. You are God's gift. And then secondly, you need to take the word of God seriously. You see, when you are one with God, even when you face death, there's no fear because you know who is with you. God is with you. That's the story of her mother. That can be the rest of our stories as well. We can face all kinds of challenges in life with confidence if you are one with God. So I encourage all of us, grow in that oneness with God. How can you and I be one with God? You need to recognize your worth. Right? You are special because God has chosen you. Second, how do you know that you are special? You need to recognize the word of God in our life. Right? You must receive it, understand it, believe it, so that God can be real in your hearts. How can you and I be one with God? First, how can you achieve oneness? First, you must be one with God first. If you're not one with God, we can't be one with others. So we need to be one with God. And then now we need to talk about how can you be one with others. Now, can you do me a favor? Turn the person beside you. I want to be one with you. Some of you feel very paiseh because, hey, no, like, this is husband and wife only. We're so corrupted. We're talking about one in Christ, okay? Now, some of us, a lot of us struggle with being one with people or with the body of Christ because it is not easy, right? There's a quotation that goes this way. To live above the saints we love, oh, that will be glory. To live with the saints we know, well, that's another story. Now, Jesus understands that. And that's why he said that when the oneness with others, right, Jesus has a lot to say to us. Because he knows that it was not easy for the early disciples. It's certainly not easy for us today. All right, that's why there's a lot of scriptures that will tell us how to be one with others. All right, we need to recognize our oneness need to be protected. We need to recognize our oneness need to be proclaimed. And then finally, our oneness need the passion of Christ. All right, so let me quickly share with you. Our oneness need to be protected. Verse 11, Jesus said this, I'm no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world. I come to you, Holy Father. Keep them in your name. All right, the name which you have given to me, that they may be one, even as we are one. While I was with them, I was keeping them. All right, then you come down to the last part, and I guarded them. Not one of them perished, but the son of perdition. All right, the son of perdition, commonly understood to be referring to Judas. All right. So everyone was saved. All the early disciples was kept protected by Jesus. Now when you look at the word keep, you think that it's the same word. It's actually not. And so let me show you that verse 11, the original word talks about terio, means that protect against internal corruption. The verse 12 talks about phileo, talks about protection against external threat, external attack. All right. So recognize that our oneness can be attacked. Why is that so? Because you saw the context. We are in the world. We are not off the world. Right? The church, We, the body of Christ, we are in the society. And therefore, the value system of the society can infiltrate into the church as well. And so we need to guard against that. So let me give you some examples of internal corruption. Our faith can be, our unity, our oneness can be compromised if we are not careful. When there's, for example, wrong teaching or certain teaching that creep into the body of Christ. So for example, there's a teaching that goes on to tell people that please check the preaching of your senior pastor. If your senior pastor preaching doesn't have ABC, he's preaching heresy. Now, some of you may not have heard this before, but this has been going on in Singapore for a while now. All right? As a result, BBTC, we have lost some young adults because of some such teaching. I know of churches where their entire young adult ministry were destroyed by such teaching. And we're not talking about far away, we're talking about in Singapore. All right? So you can see that certain teaching divides the body of Christ, divides our unity, divides our oneness. So we need to guard against such teaching. The other thing that can affect our oneness, our unity, is when we misbehave. Right? When we misbehave, when we don't live out the word of God. Now that's why in BBTC we are very careful. We talk about the three C's. You remember the three C's? No what? No comparison. Why no comparison? Because can you imagine you go to a cell group and people always compare. Today you carry this handbag, tomorrow I carry this handbag. Then today, how many children you have? You have one children, I'll have two children. Where school do your son go to? Oh, my son go to this elite school. How do you feel when you come to an environment that's so competitive? So comparison, all right? It's toxic, it's not healthy, you don't feel good. All right, so that's comparison. So we recognize these are actually pride at work. So when we misbehave and we start to assert our pride, it will divide. What's the other C? Huh? Competition, all right? So, Brother Jeff, how many tickets have you reserved for Celebration of Hope? Oh, five, then I must have eight, man. Okay, so when that happens, then it makes the whole circle very tense, okay? Everybody try to outdo one another, all right? So it will not be healthy for the cell group. The last one, which is condemnation, right? Ayo, you're so terrible. You wear like that to church, ah? How do you feel? How come you like that? Come so late for cell group some more. Please come on time for cell group, ah? But can you imagine when we begin to judge people, we begin to condemn people, we don't feel good. It divides us up. Then there's another C. We voted this C as the most popular sermon of the year. You remember that C? Complaining. The complaining sermon. Remember the complaining sermon? All right. So that's the other C. Can you imagine you come to cell group, then this person keep complaining. Aircon too hot, aircon too cold, food too much, food too little, sermon too long, sermon too short. So all these divide us. And then of course the last C called the car park. We remember the car park. So BBTC, we must crucify all these five C's, okay? Because these are toxic. When we misbehave, we break the unity of the cell. We break the love in the cell. So we need to guard against that. Then we talk about external attack. For us in Singapore, what's the external attack we have? Right, when people begin to intimidate us or challenge us about our faith or about our stand on morality, or when we stand up for family. But that's all we face here. Do you know that 50% of Christianity, of churches in the world, the kind of attack they have is physical. Right? There are churches in the world today where they can't even have a service in peaceful time because they don't know when someone will drop a bomb inside their church. And we're not talking very far, just down south. Right? And all this seek to break our unity, they seek to break our faith in God. Right? What will help us to protect our unity? What will help us to protect our oneness? Sanctify them by your truth. What will really help us to stay one in God is that we need to come back to discipleship. We need to build strong disciples that can discern the word of God so that we will not be corrupted by the things of this world. We need to build strong disciples so that even when we are attacked physically, we will have the resilience in God to stand up for our faith. Can I hear amen? Right, we need to come back to, we need to, that's why Jesus prayed for us that we must be sanctified by the truth, and the truth is the word of God. I'm not saying go for discipleship classes. We need to go for discipleship classes. But the aim is that we will live by the word. Right? So it doesn't matter how many sermons you have heard. It doesn't matter how many discipleship classes you have attended. The question is that, have you lived out the word of God? Sanctify them by the truth. And it requires us to live out the truth. So what is discipleship? May I quickly give you a quick definition? Discipleship is knowing God, loving God, serving God, following God. And the sequence is important because you need to know God, you need to understand who He is, then you can love Him. And then because you love Him, therefore you serve Him, therefore you follow Him. So I want to encourage us, we need to come back to basic, we need to come back to build up our faith in God. Now, specifically for cell group, specifically for our body life, what are some truths that you and I must learn to live by to build a strong oneness in our cell group? Because of time, let me just quickly give you three scriptures that I want to encourage all of us in the cell group to learn to embrace and live it out. The three verses. First one, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep watch over your soul as those who will give an account. Let them do with joy, not with grief, for this will be unprofitable for you. Now, I'm not using this to tekan you all, okay? But just to help you to understand that we need to establish a proper authority structure. Just like in a family, a healthy family have a healthy authority structure. In a cell group, there must be a proper authority structure. All right? And why do we do that? Why do we submit? Why do we obey our leaders? Because God holds them accountable. God holds your leaders accountable for you. All right, so obey them, submit to them. Now, I've discovered that the cell group that is growing, the cell group that is healthy, I never find a cell group that is healthy and growing because they disobey their leaders. Have you seen of any cell group that grow very well because they disobey their leaders? Don't have. Unless the leaders tell them to do to disobey God, that's another thing. But otherwise, the cell group that is growing is when they have proper honor given to their leaders. So I encourage all of us in our body life, let's honor our leaders. The second scripture I want to give to you that will help us in our oneness is encourage one another. Encourage one another to love and good deeds. All right? Consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds. You see, a healthy cell group doesn't come together just to count the number of times. The healthy cell group come together, will encourage one another how to love more, how to do good works, because our faith is demonstrative. Right, so I know of a cell group that when they decided that they will not just be a cozy, lovey cell group. They want to be a cell group that loves the community. So they adopted an elderly person from our BCS work. Every Saturday, they will deliver food for a year. After that, the cell group said that they want to do more. They stimulate one another to do more. So the following year, what they did was they began to raise money and they went into the family and tried to do up the house for the old person because the old person was not able to maintain the house. Right, so they did that. And now they're thinking about how, as a cell group, they can go for mission together. Now, as they do that, as they consider to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, what God is doing, God adds a lot of people into that cell group because the cell group is exciting. And not only that the cell group have a lot of people added to it, the cell group is also very strong with one another. So I want to encourage you, in your cell group, don't just look at yourself. Right? Think about how you can stimulate one another to love and good deeds. Especially in this season of celebration of hope. Maybe go back to your cell group and say, how can I encourage my cell member? How can I encourage one another to do good works, to love the lost around us? And last night, I heard a cell group where they came together. They say one of the applications they want to do is they want to go to Orchard Road and they want to send out flyers to the Filipinos to invite them for the Celebration of Hope on Sunday. Right, now, I'm not saying that that's the only thing you do. I'm just giving you examples. Right, I know that there are a lot of creative people around you. Just I want to encourage you to think and just say, how can we stimulate one another to love and good deeds? The final verse I want to give to you as a body life, how can we preserve our unity? Equip the saints, all right? Equipping the saints for the work of service. All right, we are interested in your growth, all right? All the cell leaders, we are all interested in your growth. We don't want you to stay stagnant, all right? So if this year you are a new disciples, by next year we pray that you become a growing disciples, All right, after that, of course, maturing disciples. Now, this year, if you are come to cell group, you come to church, people pray for you. We hope that by next year, you'll be praying for others. Can you hear amen? All right, that's where we want. We want to see you grow in your faith, that you'll be equipped for the work of service. Right, so, and that's what I hope to see in every cell group. When you look at one another, how can we help one another to grow in our faith, that we can be equipped for service? So what can you do this period? I want to encourage you. What we can equip one another for service. The Andrew Initiative book has been given to all of you in the cell group. If you don't have, you can download from the website. Practice the Andrew Initiative booklet. How you can share your story, how you can share the fall. All right, so that we can encourage one another in the cell group for the work of service. All right, so these are the three verses I give to you. All right. And it all got to do with the fact that our unity, our oneness need to be protected, all right? Because there are influences that come. How can it be protected? We need to be sanctified by the truth. We need to have the Word of God live out in our cell group, in our oneness. Secondly, I want to share with you is that our oneness need to be proclaimed. Jesus said this, all right? Verse 20 to 23, that they also may be in us. So we're talking about oneness, right? For what? That the world may believe that you sent me. So our oneness is not just for our own entertainment. Our oneness is to make sure that the world will know that God sent Jesus. Just in case you missed it, Jesus repeated himself at verse 23, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that you have sent me. Our oneness is not to be an end in itself. Our oneness is not so that we can celebrate, oh, I have a great cell group. My cell group have the best cheng teng. It's not for that purpose. Our cell group is so that when we are one, so that people can see that God is real. Church, I want you to know your cell group have a higher purpose than just coming together every Friday. Your cell group come together to celebrate the oneness so that people can look at your cell group and say that God is real. That's the purpose of our cell group. That's the purpose of our oneness, that we will testify to the world that God is real. Now, just in case you missed that, the Apostle John gave us another verse to encourage us in chapter 13. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. What's the purpose of us having love for one another? That the world may know we are his disciple. In other words, what he's saying is this, your love for one another, our oneness with others, authenticate the ministry of Jesus. God wants us to love one another, not so that we lovey-dovey, we are full of love for one another as an end, but rather so that it can become a testimony that we are God's disciple, that God is real, that Jesus is real, and Jesus is at work in the cell group. Jesus is at work in his body, and that caused the body to be able to love one another. Our oneness is meant to be proclaimed. All right? So how do we achieve oneness? We need to be one with others. We need to recognize our oneness will be attacked. We need to protect it by the word of God. We need to be sanctified by the word. Secondly, our oneness needs to be proclaimed. It is not for ourselves. It is to declare to the world that we serve a living Savior, a loving Savior. And then finally, our oneness needs to have the passion of Christ. And the passion of Christ, I'm really talking about the love of God. When we think about the word passion, always we think about the youthful passion. That's not the meaning. The word passion, according to the Latin word, means suffering, the enduring. You see, when Christ says the passion of Christ, God loved us and it cost him. That's the passion of Christ. Our oneness requires that. Our oneness requires his passion. The final part of chapter 17, from 23 to 26, Jesus said this, I in them and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you send me and love them even as you have loved me. Now, sometimes when we read too quick, you missed it. Huh? So let me slow down and share with you this. you sent me and you love them. Who's the them there? All of us. The Father God loved us. And how does He love us? Even as He has loved Jesus. Now, just in case you don't see that, let me show you. He repeated again in the last part. So that the love with which you love me may be in them. So what Jesus is really praying is this, that even as Jesus is one with the Father, He asked the Father, Father, the love that you have for me, Lord, pour the same love to your disciples. How much does God the Father love Jesus? Do you think God the Father loved Jesus a lot? Can I hear amen? Yes. Right? And that is the prayer, that's the prayer of Jesus. God, I know you love me a lot. The same level of love you have for me, pour it to your disciples. That's the prayer, that's the cry of Jesus for you and I. God wants you to experience the love of the Father God, the depth of love that He has for the Son to be poured out to you. Why is that important? Because you and I cannot love apart from the love of God. You and I cannot achieve oneness in our own strength. We need the passion of Christ. We need the love of our Father God. We need the Father, we need the love of God to sustain us, to be one with God, to be one with others. That's the most important part of our journey with God. We need to experience the love of our Father God to sustain us. Let me just summarize the sermon. Okay. How you and I can achieve oneness. First, you and I must be one with God. You need to recognize our worth, that we are special. We are a gift to God. And how do you ensure that? You need to recognize the Word of God in your life. All right. You need to be able to receive it. You need to be able to understand it so that you can believe it. And then not only that, you need to be one with others. One with others is the most difficult, right? Because you leave it out all the time. Recognize that our oneness will be attacked. Right? And therefore, you need to live by the Word of God to guide us. And then we need to know that our oneness is not just for ourselves, it's to celebrate it so that people can see Jesus. And then our oneness, we need the love of God. We need the passion of God to fill us, to empower us. I started my sermon by sharing with you about the story between a father and a son, me and my son. I'm going to end this sermon by sharing with you another father and another son. And I'm talking about Father God and Jesus. Because what they did at Calvary, what Father God and Jesus did at Calvary, made it possible for us to become one with God. If not for Calvary, you and I can never be one with God. We can never be one with others. Calvary is where the goodness of God, the glory of God converge. Calvary is where we can experience His love. Our human love is never enough. And so what I'm going to do today, I'm going to play for us a video clip on the Passion Week. And I hope that as we watch the Passion Week again, that may the Lord, not just to remind us that Good Friday is coming, but more than that, may the images invoke within us a new appreciation and a new love for Jesus, a new love for God, so that we can achieve the oneness with God. As we watch this, what Jesus has done for us, that we may find the strength to love the people around us, that we will be willing to be one with the people next to us. After the video clip, the Lord's Supper will be served as we watch the video clip. At the end, please hold the elements, because at the end of the video clip, we'll partake the Lord's Supper together. The Lord's Supper is a tangible reminder of the cross. The Lord's Supper elements is a visual representation of the body of Christ and the blood of Jesus. And that we'll do at the end of the video clip. All right, so can you sit back now as the video clip is being played. Just allow the images to remind us again on the Passion of Christ. Thank you.
little children, we would dream of Christmas morn, of all the gifts and toys we knew we'd find. But we never realized a baby born one blessed night gave us the greatest gift of our lives. We were the reason that He gave His life. We were the reason that He suffered and died. To a world that was lost, He gave all He could give.
Dark and cloudy day, a man hung crying in the rain. All because of love, all because of love. Oh, and we were the reason that He gave His life. We were the reason that He suffered.
Just to close our eyes and allow the images to come back to our mind and to help us to appreciate again the love of God for you. Jesus went all the way for you. Not for the person on your left or the right, but for you. You're that special. You're that special to God. How do I know? Because the Word of God tells us so. And not only that He loved you, He died for you. And He will give you a reason to live. You and I can have a new reason to live because of what Jesus has done. You're not here by accident. You're here because God has brought you here. And God wants you to know He loves you very much today. God loves you very much today. And right now we come to the table of the Lord. Just hold up the bread and just think about the body that was scarred for us, the body that was scarred for us. And the Lord said this on that night, that this bread represents His body. Let's thank God together for the body. Lord, we want to thank You. We want to thank You for this body that's broken for us. That You endure the scourging, You endure the beating, You endure even death, physical death at the cross, so that we can experience healing, that we can experience Your healing because of Your stripes You bore. So this very day, Lord, as we partake of this body, this very bread that represents Your body, Lord, release Your healing upon Your sons and daughters, the physical, the emotional, and the mental. Lord, release that healing upon Your people today as we partake of this bread by faith in Jesus' name. Let's partake of this together. Thank You, Jesus. In the like manner, the Lord said that this cup represents His blood. And we saw just now how the blood was shed for us, how the blood was spilled for us. The Lord loved you. The Lord loved us. And so, Lord, right now we want to thank You for this cup that represents the blood. And we thank You from Your scripture that tells us that, Lord, that Your blood cleanses us. Cleanses us of our sins and cleanses us of the sins done to us. Lord, we thank You. We thank You that not only Your blood cleanses us, we thank You that Your blood covers us. Your blood protects us. Lord, we thank You. We thank You that Your blood is a symbol of a new covenant given to us. We thank You, Lord. And so right now, as we partake of Your blood, as we partake of this cup representing Your blood, Lord, release a new level of cleansing, a new level of covering, and new assurance of this covenant upon Your sons and daughters today, as we partake of this by faith in Jesus' name.